Hi, and welcome back to my channel, where I take up way too big problems and try and condense them into the tiniest, purest forms of the arguments. In this case, we're looking at everything I learned about AI at Stanford. It's a mouthful, I must admit. It's the biggest video I've ever taken on. There's some legal problems too. Not only because of the material, there's also some legal issues. See, I'm not allowed to use any of the course material, I'm not allowed to use any of the articles, because most of them are owned by Harvard Business Review or Stanford. Yes. But luckily, I take a lot of notes, and I am allowed to share my understandings and pretty much the material that I learned. I just can't show you the actual material they used to teach you. So I think we're actually good. But before we really get into what's in this, we need to bring everybody up to speed. What is AI? It's called artificial intelligence, and it's the computer science term for allowing computers to think like you and I. There's two different categories. There's strong AI or general AI, and then there's weak AI. Weak AI is the only thing we can create right now. A quick example of that would be creating a computer that could tell the difference between muffins and cats in pictures. That's weak AI. That can only, that computer, that algorithm can only be used to determine rather whatever is in these pictures is a muffin or a cat. Don't think that you can only use artificial intelligence for pictures though. You can use it for pretty much anything, but pictures are usually the greatest example tool. Strong AI or general AI is a very, very different beast. This is the type of AI that you can apply to anything and it will understand it really quickly. It will outperform humans very, very, very quickly. We haven't seen any examples of strong AI, and these are also the AIs that Elon Musk is super afraid of, that Mark Zuckerberg is so excited for. It's definitely a diversifying topic. But it is also very different to distinguish between the two, because one we can actually experience with now, and one is some years out into the future. We'll get back to strong AI in the end, but for now, let's just continue with the muffin example. So we want to create an algorithm that can distinguish muffins from cats. Usually when you program anything, you write this instruction manual for the program, basically telling it what to do in every situation. That's not how AI works. Instead, you collect a lot of data and then you write algorithms that will try and find statistically significant differences between the two and therefore be able to distinguish between the two pictures in the end. So you basically allow the program itself to create its intelligence. You just provided enough data and it will work. In theory, you could do this with any problem, and as long as you have at least one hidden layer, I'll get to that in a minute, then depending it had unlimited times, it would be able to distinguish anything. But what are the hidden layers? That's the interesting bits, right? In an artificial intelligence, there's this network called the neural network, which is inspired by the human brain, and it consists of a lot of small neurons that mimic the neural pathways we have in our brains. That's why we call it deep learning, because we have different amounts of layers depending on how big the problem actually is. So in every neural network, there's at least one hidden layer. So you'll have a lot of neurons stacked on top of each other. You'll have the hidden layer, and then you'll have a second row of neurons stacked on top of each other. And each layer will decipher the picture further because it knows what the previous layer has. So let's say in the typical image examples, you'll have the first layer looking at, for instance, vertical lines, and then you'll have the second layer look at horizontal lines, and you'll have a hidden layer again, and a third layer that will look at round shapes, for instance. And when you get out to layer 9 or 10, you'll usually have a network that will be able to understand the picture more as a whole. So it'll, for instance, look at the circle with the ears and it'll recognize that that's a cat. Like, it will get beyond the point of only looking at certain colors or certain horizontal or vertical lines and actually understand the image. The reason why I said before that you can have a simple neural network that only has one hidden layer that will understand all of this is because with enough data, you can have all of these layers condensed down to the core of the actual problem. But this will take so much time that nobody does it. You always try and optimize your network by having not too many layers, but have enough layers so that the machine itself can work efficiently. So a hidden layer is what connects two neuron layers. And the neuron layers themselves each hold a certain measurement or a certain understanding in the images, and that's how it works. I'm not going to get too much into different ways of training the networks, but the main three are supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. And they're basically just using labels or not using labels or using reinforcement to force the machine to learn in a certain way. It does make a big difference. The biggest difference is in the way you gather your data. If you have a lot of good data that's labeled, you'll definitely allow the computer to learn from the images faster. So no matter how you decide to train your network, it will still be a very computer-heavy assignment. It takes so much computing power to train these networks. That's why people rent GPUs in order to run these. Google's TensorFlow runs on huge GPUs where you can rent space to basically run your algorithms, because that's where the main computing power is. Once you've trained the network, you can apply it to anything, and it's basically like a string of numbers you just plug in and it'll understand. But to get to that point, you need to train it. And you need to take care of your data. So pruning the algorithm is a very important part of it. After you've trained your algorithm in general, you need to prune the data. This is called synaptic plasticity, and it's basically cleaning out the neurons that doesn't do what they're supposed to do. If they don't apply actual value to the overall algorithm, take them out, because they just take up space and they just take up computing power. So you allow the algorithm to basically go back and look at what it's done and how it's made its decisions and see if some of the neurons don't really account for a lot of the differences. Let's say that there's a neuron that determines the amount of black in the image. But it turns out that cats can be black and muffins can be black, so this particular neuron doesn't really allow the algorithm to distinguish between the two pictures, then that neuron should be reused to something else. Let's say instead look at spots. So is this spot a fur spot or is it a chocolate bit inside the muffin? This is just an example, of course, but this is why neural pruning is so important to optimize the learning process of your actual algorithm. If you really want to learn more about this, then look into geon theory. Geon theory is basically the theory that all objects are made of elementary particles, or geons. An example could be geometric shapes, which can be made up of the simplest of shapes, and then you add them together and you can create all sorts of complex shapes. This is important to understand, that this is basically what the neuron layers are trying to do. It's trying to distinguish different simple structures and then combine them to describe the overall images that it gets. That being said, you don't need to understand more than that. Okay, so to sum up, we now know how a neural network functions, how an artificial intelligence makes its decisions, and where it finds its intelligence from. But before we talk about the how, let's look at why. When would you ever use artificial intelligence? Because people usually say you'll use artificial intelligence to improve every aspect of life, but that's not true. An artificial intelligent machine will never be better than us at saying what 2 + 2 is. Creating an artificial intelligence that can count makes no sense, because everyone can count, and counting is a linear problem. So following a Boolean logic, you don't need to create an artificial intelligence, because you could just write the 3 rules it takes to get to the end result. That being said, people have taken this to the extreme. Now we're talking about Boolean logic, which is any problem that is linear, you have no reason to create an artificial intelligence for, because you can just create the rules. You can just say A this, B this. But a nonlinear problem, this is where artificial intelligences will really thrive, because you can use artificial intelligence to create rules for nonlinear problems that you can't otherwise create. At least it will be very difficult to create them for humans. And now, finally, to the how. How does these neural networks make their decisions? We have the 2 neural layers with the neurons inside, and we have the hidden layer in between. Connecting all of these neurons are what's called weights, which is numbers associated to each neuron that tells how much it should impact the end result. Basically, how accurate has these neurons been in the past at predicting whether or not this is A or B in the end. That's honestly how they do it. It's that simple. It just looks for statistical significance and then chooses the one with the highest significance. That's it. That's honestly, that's how the neural networks function. And now that we understand that, there's of course way too many different ways to structure these neural networks. And this is where it gets really interesting, because the topic of artificial intelligence is moving so quickly right now. So I did my final paper on convolutional networks and CAPSnets. CAPSnet is a thing that came out in October of last year. It's not even like not even a year old. It's that recent. If you wanted to create a solution for our previous muffins and cat problem, half a year ago you would have used what's called a convolutional neural network, which adds a convolutional layer that basically compresses the image files down to the simplest and rawest form. Now though, people are starting to talk about 3D neural networks, or capsules. That's where this CAPSnet comes in. And CAPSnet has proven to perform way better than convolutional networks ever did on images. But of course, keep in mind, I'm saying this even though the CAPSnet neural networks have not actually been tested on huge datasets yet. I actually wrote my final paper on this. I'll link to it down below if you want to read it. It's really interesting how fast the thing moves, and I apply it to the use of alpha keying, basically taking out the background of whatever you're in without even using green screens. It is technically possible. I haven't seen great results from it yet though, but yes, it's very, very, very interesting. I'm super stoked that you watched this video and got to this part. If you like the video, then subscribe. I try and make a lot of videos like these as often as I can. But yeah, I better end this video now. I'll probably make a continued studies series. If you'd like to hear more of what we learned at the Stanford course, this did cover basically all of it, but we can go into depth of each and every one of the topics I've mentioned, and we can talk about alternative neural networks that are better at audio files or text files. There's so much. So yeah, leave a like on the video if you like that. Let me know in the comments down below if you have any suggestions, and thank you so very much for watching. Subscribe to the channel if you're new. I really do put in so very much effort, and I do love doing this, so I hope you enjoyed it. I'll see you guys next week. Take care.